the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. Last Sunday, I did not know what had just happened in Orlando. People asked me at coffee hour if I heard the news, and I hadn't heard the news because I get up and study for my sermon in the morning, and I purposely don't turn on the news. So needless to say, it grieved me that we had all been here praying and I hadn't known what had happened. And when something fills up the news space and my heart feels empty, I go to Scripture, not only to see what I've got for the next Sunday coming up, but to see how the Scripture answers exactly what has happened to our country and to all of us as Americans as we ponder the massacre in Orlando. So I read this reading of the Gerasene demoniac, as it's called, thinking I knew what the story was about, because I've often talked about mental illness with the Gerasene demoniac, that it's a lot like mental illness, and we don't understand that. But I saw a completely different interpretation of it, and I will share you what my thoughts have been this week. Notice in the story, in this gospel story, how Jesus returns the man who had the demons back to his community. I had always looked at that as, oh, that poor man, he wants to be with Jesus. And Jesus is saying, no, go back to your people and tell them what God has done for you. And that is in total keeping with the healings he has done so far in the gospel according to Luke. Remember the centurion's servant who was near death. When Jesus was able to heal him from a distance, he never actually even touched the man, that man's servant was returned to him. They were reunited and became a unit again, or a community, if you will. And then the woman whose son had died, Jesus took that son and he sat up and was alive again, and he gave the son back to his mother, reuniting him with his family relationships and with the community around that family. He's doing the same thing in this little story. He's returning the man to his community, and he gives him a mission statement. He says, tell everyone what God has done for you. And it says, the text says, and he went back to his community and told them what Jesus had done for him. Wow, I never noticed that before. Isn't that wonderful how it just pops out? And then I looked a little bit closer at the community that he was coming from. And I used to own pigs, so I've always looked at this story as those poor pigs. They are such smart animals. Don't kill the pigs. I like the story except for the part about the pigs. I'm trying to get over that. It's so hard to come to Scripture with a fresh mind and look at it for some other message it might have for us. But I looked at how Jesus was listening to the voices of the demons. Let's start at the beginning. The demons recognized Jesus. Remember, Jesus has this wonderful being of God in him that only the demons are able to recognize. They say, stay away from us. We don't want anything to do. So when Jesus gets out of the boat with his disciples, nobody from this town of Gerasa, nobody has come to greet them from the town except this one guy who lives in the tombs. And he's obviously broken off his bonds and his shackles, because we're told that's how they lock him up in the tombs. He broke them off, and instead of running into the wild, he came down to Jesus at the beach. And the man threw himself down in honor of the holy man who he recognized coming out of the boat. And then Jesus asked him his name. And he said, my name is Legion, for there are hundreds of demons that have possessed me. And then look what these demons have done. They are not sending him as a wild man when he loses his shackles and his chains. Does he run into the midst of his community and start shooting people? He is not a terrorist. These demons take him from his community and throw him into the And his community goes and finds the man. They follow him. They bring him back, and for his own safety, they chain him up so he can stay in his community, so they can feed him, so they can clothe him. Here's this guy who rips off his clothes every time. And he's part of their community. They're taking responsibility for him. They don't know what to do. They're not health professionals. They're not psychologists. They're not a healer like Jesus. Jesus comes, and he's able to free this man of his demons, but the demons start speaking now. They say, please, let us go into that herd of pigs. Any idea why they went into a herd of pigs? Yeah, I don't have any idea either, except that the pigs were there. And the pigs were Corban, or death to the Hebrew people, but not to this community. These people are not Hebrew, they're not Jewish. So they were there, born, they lived off the pigs, bacon and pork chops, everything else. So the demons begged Jesus to go into the pigs. He says, okay, go into the pigs. As soon as they were in the pigs, the demons, the pigs took them to the abyss. That's where they were praying, please don't send us back into the abyss. And where did the pigs take them? Right back to the abyss. In ancient mind, big bodies of water were representative of the abyss, which means there's no return. If you get drowned under the water, you're not coming back. Those demons have seen their last day. So they're gone. The man is free. And what Jesus does is return him to his community, healed and in his right mind. So this energy of building community is what Christ, especially the cosmic Christ in this universe in which we live, we know so much about the world around us. Everything is being drawn into this centripetal. When it's going towards the center, is that not centrifugal, that goes out, centripetal, I think is where it goes in the middle. We all look this up later. But it's all going towards the center. Jesus builds communities, and from the building of community comes this second life of God, of Jesus incarnate, that makes us a community, something bigger than any of us can be by ourselves. Think of our own little communities. We have a sewing group, we have a knitting group, we have a group that sits at the back table in the coffee hour, another group that sits over on the side table, and we've got our little communities where we sit, and our families, and we identify with them. And what happened in Orlando just blew the smithereens out of the heart of so many communities. Three of them that have been haunting me this week. The first, of course, is the LGBT community. Lesbian, gay, trans, bisexual, queer, questioning, non-dual, and all sorts of new labels that are coming out. But this community has for hundreds of years been targeted by terrorists. This is nothing new for this community. And it brings this feeling of dread and exposure that they have no safe place anymore. Because a bar, a place where they go and listen to music and dance, is their safe place. When the safe place is invaded, all of their anonymity is thrown, and they are, it's not just the lives that were lost, community not being safe. And then we have the Hispanic community, most of whom are Puerto Rican. And in America, we have a strange relationship with Puerto Rico. Are they American? Are they not American? It's kind of this, do we give to them? Are they part of us? Well, no, they don't feel part of us in a lot of communities, and they have their own structure that they nourish each other. So the Puerto Rican community felt very vulnerable, still feels vulnerable, felt targeted. And then the identity of the gay people that the parents didn't even know were gay in Puerto Rican. All of that was not honored. And then there's the Muslim community. And every time we hear news of some other attack, a massacre, all of our Muslim Americans are praying, please, Allah, God be with you. Don't let it be a Muslim that committed this horrible crime. And when it is, all of the Muslim Americans in this country are bereft. Their heart is broken. And they want to tell all of us, that man was not a Muslim. That is not Islam that you saw. That was a crazy man with hate in Islam is a religion of love. Islam is one of the Abrahamic faiths. Like Judaism, like Christianity, Islam worships the same God. Allah means God. And this is the holy month of Ramadan. And in Ramadan, every person has a spiritual journey. It's their pilgrimage. And the word used for pilgrimage in their faith is jihad. And jihad means you come naked before God and say, what is it that keeps me from you? How do you want me to build community? How can I live out your love in my community? And to have somebody say that this was in the name of this loving God just ripples through the whole Muslim American community. So what can we do? We can come together like this. We can talk about what really hurts and name it. And then once we've named it, we can know how to pray. We can pray for strength for our Muslim neighbors. We can pray for strength for the parents who not only lost a child, but learned that their child had been gay and was afraid to tell them. Pray for them. Pray for the survivors. Pray for all communities that we in this big conglomerate of the United States can celebrate our differences and welcome people who are not like us or appear to be not like us, but really are a lot like us, that we can be welcoming to them and tell them with all our heart, we pray for you, we mourn with you, and it breaks our heart that your community was ruptured in this way. And then we can see the community that we have and thank God that we have it. And thank God for our fathers and for our families of origin or our families that we've created to replace those families. In some cases, we have families that we've made up ourselves. God bless our communities. God bless the love that we share, and we pray that we will be open to new changes and new ways of being compassionate to our fellow humans.